are holy, holy are you, Lord God Almighty. Worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb. You are holy, holy are you, Lord God Almighty. Worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb. You are holy, holy are you, Lord God Almighty. Worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb. You are holy, holy.
Rise up. He is risen.
He is risen indeed. And we welcome you to Fellowship Fayetteville Easter here in Fayetteville, Arkansas. We're grateful for you as our church family. You're our guest to be here. You can have a seat. My name's Clark, and I have the privilege of serving as one of the pastors here at Fellowship Fayetteville. And so if this is your first time with us and there's a buzz in the room, parents, you can drop your shoulders. It's okay. It's okay if your children are a little bit loud this morning. We celebrate the sound of those voices, the next generation of the church. Two times a year, Christmas Eve and Easter, we have a celebration, and we do that as a whole family. And so we're doing that here this morning. Would also invite you back if you're a guest, and for those of you that are regular attenders, next week we begin a four-month study in the Gospel of Mark, and we're going to walk through that together and try to understand what does it look like to orient our lives around and under the authority of King Jesus. What does it mean to be a disciple, a follower of Jesus? And so if you've got questions about what it means to follow Jesus, about Christianity, that will help unpack some things for you as we look at the words of Mark and his documentation of the gospel together. Well, we're excited to celebrate something really cool this morning. Brian and Hallie, come on up here, and we're glad that all of you are in here to celebrate this with us. One of the first statements that Jesus made to his disciples happened the evening of resurrection morning. And he said this to them. He said, "Even as the Father has sent me, so send I you." One of the applications of believing in the resurrection of Jesus is to go and tell. Hallie's going to do that, and she's flying out this Thursday. And so Brian's going to tell a little bit about her story. Brian?
Yeah, we are so excited. And actually, we're so proud of you, Hallie. She is going to be leaving, like Clark said, Thursday morning. She's going to be going to live full-time in the country of Japan. She'll be joining Kyle and Elise in the work that they're doing there, which is church planting. And the goal of this network is to see a church planted in every major city in Japan. And I was just reminded just the other day, we had an event with our international students. We were taking them horseback riding, but we met over here in this parking lot. And it was on Good Friday. And it was so cool just to see there was car after car of probably some of y'all coming to take communion and to pray in remembrance of Good Friday. Matter of fact, so many cars went by that two of the students, one from Taiwan and one from Iraq, came up to me and said, "Hey, why are so many people coming to church on Friday?" And I got to tell them that, hey, this is the day that we observe Jesus when he went to the cross for a sacrifice for our sins. And on Sunday, we're going to celebrate him rising from the grave. As a matter of fact, our whole foundation of what we believe is built on Easter. And their response was, they had no idea. And Hallie, that's why you're going, that there's 3 billion people who don't know that message that we just shared right there. And you were a part of that ministry, and we got to see you develop a relationship with a girl from South Korea, and God used you to help call her into his family. As a matter of fact, she was baptized right over there, and it was just such a confirmation, I think, of what you've set your life to do. She spent the past 3 years getting ready for this moment. And so could we as a church family just pray for her? And what we like to do, just when we commission somebody just to show visually that the church is behind her and we're supportive of her, we just ask that you would just raise one of your hands up in the air as we pray over her. Join me. Dear God, we are just so excited of what Hallie has chosen to do, and dear God, how she is stepping out in faith. And I remember the first time that we met with her, dear Lord, and just the fear that she had, but she just wanted to be obedient to you. And God, that we've just seen her transform over these past couple years, and you've just given her just a confidence, dear Lord, in what she's doing and what you've called her to do. And God, we pray that you would go before her, dear God. We pray that you would help her learn the language quickly. We pray that you would surround her with a community of believers, and we pray that she would be effective and clear in sharing the gospel. And dear God, may she be an instrument that you use to call new people into your kingdom. And God, may because of what this team is doing, that they see a church planted in every major city in Japan, dear God, so people would know the sacrifice that you made for them. We thank you and we celebrate that Jesus really did die on a cross and he really was risen from the grave. And it's your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Come on down, Colson. Church family, I want to introduce you to a friend of mine. His name is Colson Davis, and he's the most courageous young man in the room this morning. And so, Kurt, Sarah, if you guys could come up, Sarah, and your family. A few months back, we were visiting. Actually, we bumped into each other at the gym, and we were having a discussion about baptism and what it means, what it doesn't mean, and what it means to celebrate in front of your church family. And Colson just knew that he believed in Jesus and that Jesus had paid for his sins and had come back to life to give him eternal life. And I want you to know, Colson, that this morning in front of your church family, in Jesus Christ, you're going to be a man who does great things. God's going to use you to help others come to know him. And that in Jesus Christ, you're going to be the man that he's created you to be. And you need to know that this morning. Can y'all give Colson a hand for his courage this morning? Yeah. Well, Colson, is it your testimony to your church family that you put your trust in Jesus and you believe that he rose again from the grave to give you life?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Well, based on that profession, I baptize you, my brother, now, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ in baptism, raised to walk in the newness of life.
Amen. Well, good morning, church. If this is not your normal church home, if you're visiting us this morning, there's something that we do on a regular basis here at Fellowship Fayetteville. It's part of our liturgy. It's part of our rhythms as a church. And that's to confess corporately together our sin, our need for a Savior, and then to remind ourselves of our assurance of pardon in Christ Jesus. And just like Colson, the first step in his walk of faith is to realize that he's a sinner. He's in need of a Savior, that he cannot save himself by any type of good works or clearing out all the bad thoughts in his life. There's no amount of good that we can do to save ourselves. And so we, in fact, every one of us in this room, we need a Savior. And so let's confess that together this morning. Heavenly Father, have mercy on us. We have not loved you as you deserve. We have not loved our neighbor as ourselves. We have not obeyed you as we should. Lord, forgive us our sin. We are in need of a Savior. And 40 days ago, we had an Ash Wednesday service in this room, and we took some black drapes and we wrote with Sharpies, we confessed sin on those black drapes, and we hung them on the cross, and they hung there for the past 40 days to remind us of our brokenness and our sinfulness. And this morning, if you notice the cross, the drapes have been changed to white to remind us that those sins have been paid for, that we have been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, the name above every name, the King of Kings. He's the image of the invisible God. He came to earth to pay that price for our sins when we could not do it ourselves. Praise God that our salvation lies in him and not in us. And so if you believe in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus, there's good news, church. So believe the good news that Jesus died for us. Jesus rose for us. Jesus intercedes for us. In him, we are a new creation. In him, we have forgiveness of sin. In him, we have a Savior. To God be the glory forever and ever. Amen. If you would, let's stand together as we continue to worship and sing praises to the King of Kings this morning.
I was a wretch. I remember who I was. I was lost. I was blind. I was running out of time. Sin separated. The breach was far too wide. But from the far side of the chasm, you held me in your sight. So you made a way across the great divide. Left behind heaven's throne to build it here inside. And there at the cross, you paid the debt I owe. Broke my chains, freed my soul. For the first time I had hope. So thank you, Jesus, for the blood applied. Thank you, Jesus, it has washed me white. Thank you, Jesus, you have saved my life. Brought me from the darkness into glory. Right out again, and now death has no sting, and life has no end. For I have been transformed by the blood of the Lamb. So thank you, Jesus, for the blood applied. And thank you.
Got me a little bit. Let's pray. Well, Father, you saw fit to send your Son, not to be served, but to serve and give his life as a ransom for many, that we might walk in newness of life in him. We look back on Good Friday and we say thank you. We ask that you would remind us on Easter the victory that we have in your Son. And we pray this in your name, Jesus, our King. Amen. You may grab a seat. Good morning. How are we this morning? Phenomenal. In the front. How are we? Good enough? All right, good enough. If you're joining us in live stream or the foyer or the classroom or the student center, we're so glad that you are here. My name's Garland. I'm one of the pastors here, and I would like to just simply ask you, and we've probably all had a moment like this in our life. I want you to think of a moment, and maybe we have many of these kinds of moments, think of a moment where your hopes were high, like you had high expectations, and then it didn't really deliver in the end what you were hoping for. Like, it could have been maybe there was a restaurant you were waiting to try, a new restaurant, and you were really looking forward to going, and then the food just didn't pan out like everybody had said. Or maybe it was a business deal or promotion that was on the horizon. You thought, man, that could be coming for me. It could be, if you look back on when you were a kid, or if you are a kid in the room, there's probably been that Christmas where you were really excited about potentially receiving a particular Christmas gift. And as Christmas approached, you started tearing through the different packages, and you're looking for, where is it? And it wasn't there. And Christmas was ruined for you because it wasn't there what you were looking forward to. We've probably all had an experience like this. Let me give you two just from the recent past for me, one more silly than the next. The first one is this. I had very high hopes for season 3 of this show. Ted Lasso, if you haven't seen it, that's what the show is. Season 1 was really good. Season 2 I was really excited about. And then as season 3 came on, like there was a lot of people, how are they going to conclude this show? And it was an abject failure. It was hot garbage all of season 3. It was just so bad, it made me wonder, did I ever even like the show in the first place? Now, if you said, like, we've done 2 services so far, people are coming up afterwards, just saying, well, I like season 3. If that's you in the room, the critics would say, you are wrong, all right? You're just wrong, okay? It was terrible, objectively so. There was another one, and if you remember back, like when COVID first hit and we were having to change things and adjust things and deal with everything that was going on, and we had graduations and proms and things we were really looking forward to and reunions that had to adjust, and sometimes it was an adjustment that just didn't match what you were expecting. I know for me, I was set to officiate a wedding that very first weekend of COVID, and was excited to do so, and as the wedding approached, it went from the venue to a backyard, and then from the backyard, it was going to be me with just the couple in the backyard, but then somebody had tested positive. We didn't know what was going on, and it went to probably my first and probably my last Zoom wedding, which is a very odd experience. This is me in my living room. I have shorts on underneath. I just put on a nice shirt, and the reality is this couple looked forward to this day. Their families looked forward to this day, and here it is, and didn't match maybe expectations. We probably all had a moment like that, maybe several. The reason we start here is this is the vibe. This is the tone that first Easter morning. And I don't want familiarity with the story to cause us to miss what they would have been feeling that first Easter morning as we step into an outrageous and audacious claim that followers of Jesus made then and today. And if we can't come face to face with how outrageous, how audacious the claim is, because of familiarity, we may have missed something this morning. So we're going to give 2 little quick things. The first is this, we're going to see about this claim. It's a claim about a story that no one was expecting. And then second, it's a claim about a story that everyone in this room deep down desires. So no one was expecting this story, and everyone desires it. If you have your Bibles, open them with me. Luke 23. If you don't have them, no big deal. If you're holding on to kids and you can't get it, no big deal, all right? Just Luke 23. We only got about 15 minutes, okay? So we're going to move quick. Bear with me. Here we go. Luke 23. We're going to enter into the story on Good Friday. We pick it up here in verse 48. When all the people who had gathered to witness this sight saw what took place, they started to grieve. Now what did they see? What is the sight that caused them to grieve? Well, it's Good Friday. See, we got to enter into the scene this way. We got to put ourselves in their shoes. Many of those people standing there, many of those who were followers of Jesus who'd walked with him for years even, they had really high hopes for who he was. They thought, man, this guy, after all, he's done some incredible things. He said some incredible things. Many Jews in the ancient world were looking for a Messiah figure, an anointed one who may come. And when this anointed king would come, he would rid us of our enemies and establish Yahweh's good kingdom and bring goodness and blessing in the world. And many had even hoped maybe this was it. And then he was brutally executed on a Roman cross. And their hopes came crashing down. When they put Jesus in the tomb after the crucifixion on Good Friday, when they pulled him down and put him into the tomb, and then they rolled the stone across, you know what? For all intents and purposes, for everyone that day, the story is over. Done. Put a period in it. Nothing more to be said. In fact, let's get out of here because we put our hopes in the wrong guy. And you can even see it in the text. Look at chapter 24, verse 1, as we turn to chapter 24. There are many, including these women, and look at their behaviors. Look at their actions. What are they doing as they go to the tomb very early that first Easter morning? What are they doing? They ain't thinking miracle. They're not thinking resurrection. You know what they're thinking? We need to put some spices on the corpse so it will not smell as bad when we come to grieve these next few months. That's what they're thinking. Now, the women see a surprising sight when they show up. The stone is rolled back. A heavenly messenger tells them, he's not here. And they're like, really confused. He's risen. Go tell his disciples. How do the disciples react? These early heroes of the faith, what's their response? Look at verse 11. They did not believe the women. Why? Because they thought they were crazy. What you are saying is nonsense. Heroes. This is their first reaction to this audacious claim. Now, why are they reacting like this? Why respond like this? See, Jews in the ancient world, Romans in the ancient world, Jesus' disciples, everyone knew that dead people stay dead. Everyone knew that dead messiahs weren't messiahs. Dead heroes weren't heroes. Everyone knew that. They'd seen this game play out before, and they'll see the same thing play out again. In fact, you can see it in your Bible. You don't have to turn there, but in Acts chapter 5, we get two of these would-be leaders, would-be heroes listed. And notice what happened to both of them. When they were killed, their movement came to nothing. They were scattered. In fact, this would play out over and over again in the ancient Jewish world. This is me just picking a handful. I could have put dozens of names on here, and I could have put the tens of thousands of their followers who we don't know their name. Notice the common denominator in all of them. You see it? Killed, 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 killed. Dead messiahs weren't messiahs. In fact, These last two were associated with the Jewish rebellion, the Jewish revolt that took place in the 60s AD, about 30 years after Jesus' death and resurrection. And when these two revolted with a lot of their followers, the Romans said, we've had enough. And they came in and they smashed out the rebellion and they destroyed the city. When you go to Rome to this day, if you've been there and you went to the Forum and you stood under the arch to Titus, right there on the right, here's the engraving of the Romans celebrating their victory over the Jews. We know what it means when would-be leader heroes die at the hands of the Romans. Rome is still in power. That person isn't who he said he is. It's over. In fact, about 100 years after Jesus, there'd be another one. He calls himself Messiah, the morning star, same common denominator. Everyone that Good Friday night, all throughout Saturday, and that first Easter morning, you know what they're thinking? Here's what they're thinking. I guess we put Jesus on the list too. He was killed after all. I guess we got it wrong. He's not the Messiah after all. And we really hoped he would be. Now, it demands historical explanation. And I'm going to invite you, if you're here this morning, and maybe you've got some big doubts about this old Jesus thing or the church or Christianity, and that's okay. I hope you know that's okay. Maybe you're just flat out skeptical. Maybe you don't buy any of this, and you're here today because you're in town because mama wanted you in town, and you're having brunch after, all right? That's why you're here. But let me just invite you. I want to invite you to consider with an open mind In fact, I might even challenge you. It demands historical explanation how a group of people who know for certain what a dead Messiah means, within a matter of hours, will go from saying, that's nonsense, to saying something radically audacious. Like even in the story, look at it, even in the story at the end of Luke 24, when Jesus appears to his followers, when he appears to them, even still, they don't get it. He says, peace with you, and they're scared. They go, is this a ghost? Is this a phantom? And he says, this is not a figment of your imagination. This is not a mass hallucination. Touch me, touch my hands, touch my feet. I'm here before you. I speak peace to you. The tomb really was empty. And a group of people who know for certain that dead people stay dead, within a matter of hours, begin to say, no, we met the risen Jesus. Not as a ghost, it's bodily resurrection. We saw him. See, it's too easy in our modern world to just dismiss these stories like this. Well, of course they believe such things. They're all idiots back then. They're gullible. They're probably expecting it. They probably see it coming. I bet their Old Testament said something about this. Can I tell you, none of that is accurate. No one is expecting this. N.T. Wright is a historian, first century theologian, historian. He says this. He says, the early Christians did not invent the empty tomb in the meetings or sightings of the risen Jesus. He says, nobody's expecting this kind of thing. No kind of conversion experience would have invented it, no matter how guilty or forgiven they felt, no matter how many hours they pored over the scriptures. Hear it. To suggest otherwise is to stop doing history and enter into a fantasy world of our own. If you're here this morning, you go, I don't buy it. Or I got some big doubts about the Bible, its ethical teachings, what it says in the Old Testament, this whole thing, I don't know. We're so glad you're here. I hope this is a safe place for you with an open mind to explore that. May I invite you, though, start with the resurrection. Start here. There are many things like this that just demand a historical explanation. I would invite you to look into it. It's too easy to dismiss it and then move aside. Dig in, lean in. It's a story nobody's expecting. It's an audacious claim. Like Jesus followers, you get how crazy it sounds, right? It's an outrageous thing to say that the tomb was empty and Jesus appeared. He has risen. But it's also the story everyone desires. Now that's a bit of an audacious claim myself, just to even say that this is the story everyone desires. By the way, in this room, whether you are a Jesus follower, you've been following him for decades, or you are not and you are a skeptic, this is the story that everyone desires. What do I mean by that? I'm gonna let Tolstoy help me. Now, don't let the Russian writer ruin your mood. All right, it's a nice day out there. It's gonna be a beautiful day. The Hogs swept LSU. We're in a great mood. Don't let him ruin your mood. But LSU fans, I'm sorry. But this is a profound question that every single one of us must confront. And it might as well be this day. Hear it. He says, my question, that which at the age of 50 brought me to the verge of despair, was the simplest of questions lying in the soul of every man and every woman. He says, a question without an answer to which one cannot live. Here's the question. You ready? Lean in. Outrageously profound for 10:07 on Easter morning. Lean in. He says, what will come of what I am doing today or tomorrow? What will come of my whole life even? Why should I live? Why wish for anything or do anything? Another way you could say it, he says, is there any meaning in my life that the inevitable death awaiting me does not destroy? When's the last time you considered? Where is this thing headed? Is there any meaning or purpose? How do you know? Like if all we are just evolved primates, if naturalism is true and all we are is evolved primates, randomly on a space rock, and one day the sun will become a red giant and it will burn up the earth, where do you find meaning? If that's the story, then death is still the conquering hero. Death still wins. Death has the final word. Death remains undefeated. And I don't even know how you orient to today. How do you orient to meaning and purpose and value? How do you find as you reach out to know, do I matter? Is what I'm doing in this world important and significant? Where do you orient? To what do you tether? This is a really profound question. I want to introduce you to another skeptic. He was so skeptical about the audacious claim of Easter, he was willing to be violent against those making it in the first century. And then he met the risen Jesus. He came face to face with Easter. And here's what he says. Does death have the final word? Are we spiraling meaninglessly, randomly on a planet? No, 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 no. Look at what Paul would say. He says, in light of the risen Jesus, in light of Easter, because of Easter even, he says, oh, I can laugh at death. Even death does not have the final word. He says, where, O death, is your victory? You remain undefeated no longer. Where, O death, is your sting? He says, the sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is in the law. But thanks be to God. Why? Because that victory that is all that Easter is all about now becomes your victory. How? Through our King Jesus the Messiah. Now see the implications. What does it mean for you today? Notice it. Therefore, stand firm. Let nothing move you. He says, everything we do now is part of a new story. Everything we do now is the work of the Lord. Don't hear that and go, church stuff. Stuff you do on Sunday or Wednesday or at a small group. No, 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 no. What he means is now everything in your life and my life, all of it is now connected to this unbelievable story. Everything, your job, your skills, your passions, all of it can be connected to the story of all stories that all of us desperately need, providing every single day for you meaning, value, purpose. He says, that way you'll run and you'll know that your labor is not in vain. In another letter, he says it this way. If you're in Christ, if you've been connected to this story, this king, he says, new creation. Here's how I like to think of it. If you're in Christ in the room, hear me. You stand on new creation soil. Jesus has inaugurated resurrection life. You know what it looks like? Reconciliation. This message of reconciliation, reconciliation to God through Jesus, reconciliation to each other, reconciliation between peoples, reconciliation to the world, because our King reigns victorious and came not to be served, but to serve and give his life as a ransom for many. Don't you see? Everything is now connected to this. Everything today is now different because of this. Right again. He says, the point of the resurrection is that the present bodily life is not valueless just because it will die. But what you do with your body in the present, today, matters because God has a great future in store for it, and it's certain in the past in Jesus' resurrection. What you do in the present, this is profound, by painting, preaching, singing, sewing, praying, teaching, building hospitals, digging wells, campaigning for justice, writing poems, caring for the needy, loving your neighbor, it will all last into God's future. You connect it to the bigger story. These activities aren't simply ways of making the present life just a little less beastly, a little more bearable. No. They're a part of what we may call God building for his kingdom. Jesus' resurrection is the beginning of God's project, not to snatch people away from earth to heaven, but to colonize earth with the life of heaven. Isn't that wonderful? Your job, skills, passion, all of it now, where you live, where you work, where you do your life, is connected to this story. If you've got questions this morning, with an open mind, if you go, I don't know about this old Jesus thing, but I want that. We invite you, we'll have some of our pastoral team down here later, just to process, what does that look like to understand Jesus as King, to connect to that story? We would love to process with you what that looks like. But if you're a Jesus follower in the room, hear it, new creation. You stand in resurrection ground. He is risen indeed, and because of that, we can have confidence and hope and assurance today. So I'm going to invite you. We're going to stand. And I'm going to invite you now, would you stand with us as we give honor and glory and praise to the one who is worthy of it. And as we sing, may we take the roof off this place because he's worthy of it. Is he not? We worship our risen King.
My light, my strength, my song, And this cornerstone, this solid ground, and firm through the fiercest drought and storm. Can we sing? And what heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease, and my comforter, and my all in all, and here in the love of Christ, I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh and fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, you scorned by the ones he came.
While we sing of the cross,
until on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid. And here in the death of Christ, I lay. Oh, 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 oh. There in the ground, his body lay, and light of the world by darkness slain, then bursting forth in glory.
Yours is the glory, yours is the name. death could not hold, death could not hold you. The veil torn before you. Sing it, church. You silence the boast of sin and grave. Heaven's a roaring, the heavens all roaring. The praise of your glory, for you are raised to life. You have no rival, you have no equal. Now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name.
Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your very body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Jesus, yours. Oh,
One more time, church, because he lives.
Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives,
we have nothing to fear.
He is risen. Now hear it. Because he lives. And it changes everything. We can have a hope, an assurance, and a confidence today that even death cannot assuage. We can have a joy that is impervious to circumstance because our King reigns. And because he lives, he holds the future. And now today we have the story, the audacious story that everyone desires. It finds its yes and its amen in our King Jesus. He conquers sin and death on our behalf. What a story. So church, if you got questions, if you want to process, what does that look like to enter that story? We'll have some of our pastoral team up here. We'd love to process that with you, what it looks like to enter into that story maybe for the first time. If you want to take communion right through your left, up those stairs, we have communion available for you. Fellowship Fayetteville. Happy Easter. We love you. See you next week.
Because he